The goal of this video is to give you an example of application of the theory of Markov chain to compute the limiting behavior and basically limiting probabilities in some kind of system. So we are going to use as example, so in our example, we assume that a woman called Alice goes to work every morning, comes back home every evening. She walks both ways, and she owns a total of R umbrellas, and each time it's raining, she's going to take an umbrella if she has one available where she is. But if she doesn't have any umbrella at her location, then she's going to get wet. So we also assume that the weather is described by a random process. So we are going to simplify things by just assuming that every morning and every evening, independently of each other, it's going to rain with the same probability P in the city where Alice lives. And so the goal again is to find the probability that she's going to get wet in the long run, which is also equal to the fraction of days in the long run she gets wet. So to study this problem, the first step is to introduce a Markov chain. And the most natural thing we need to have in mind is that she's going to get wet each time she's out of umbrellas at one location, either home or either her office, which means that we need a Markov chain that will keep track of the location of those umbrellas, for instance. So to understand what's happening, I'm going to use like those empty cans. And let's assume that this little rectangle here is Alice's home, and this is her office. And here, this means that, okay, she has three umbrellas at home, two umbrellas at her office. And then to keep track of the location of the umbrellas, what we are going to do is introduce a Markov chain Xn, where Xn is going to be equal to the number of umbrellas she has at home, the number of umbrellas at home, so in this case 3, in the morning of day n. You can also change home by office. You can keep track of the number of umbrellas at her office instead. That doesn't really change the problem. And you can keep track of the number of umbrellas in the evening instead of morning. If you change the definition, then you define a new Markov chain Xn, but eventually the limiting probabilities we want to compute will be the same. So if we want to keep track of number of umbrellas at home, home is here on the left, then and in the morning of day n. So when Alice wakes up in the morning of day n, and this is what you see, this means that your Markov chain is in state 3, okay? Here you are going to have 6 states because we have 5 umbrellas. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? There are 6 possible states. And so, as usual, when you want to study Markov chains, step number 1 is to find the transition probabilities. So I'm going to use both scans so that we can try to understand those transition probabilities. So remember that every morning, every evening, it rains independently with the same probability P. I'm going to call Q the probability 1 minus P, which is the probability that it doesn't rain. And let's see what happens. So Alice wakes up in the morning and she has 3 umbrellas at home. Now, first question is, what is the probability that she's going to have 1 less umbrella at home the day after? Well, so that she has 1 less umbrella, she needs to bring 1 at work in the morning. This will only happen if it rains, because she doesn't carry any umbrella if it doesn't rain. So you need rain in the morning. This happens with probability P, but you don't want her to bring back an umbrella in the evening. So which means you want no rain in the evening. This happens with probability Q. So eventually what we have is that if you have 3 umbrellas here, you are going to have only 2 umbrellas at home the day after with probability P times Q. Same story, if you want to bring back an umbrella, so let's go back here, and let's assume she wakes up in the morning, she has 3 umbrellas at home. What is the probability that the day after she's going to have 1 more umbrella at home? Well, then in this case, you want the same event but reversed. You want to have no rain in the morning so that she's not going to bring any umbrella at her office. But then in the evening, you want to have some rain so that she will have to take an umbrella and bring it back home. Okay? So eventually, you see that the probability of going from, let's say, state X to X plus one or X minus one, those two transition probabilities are going to be equal, and they are both equal to P times Q, okay? Where again, Q is the probability that it's not raining. So this is true when X is strictly between zero and R. Now, there is something special happening when all the umbrellas are at the same location. And notice that when all the umbrellas are at the same location, this is when she can get wet. So, in this case, what is the probability that the day after there will be one less umbrella at home? Well, again, you need rain in the morning so that she brings an umbrella here, probability P. No rain in the evening, probability Q. Again, you have the probability PQ that you lose one umbrella at home. Okay, so that's the same as before, except that the coefficient of the transition matrix on the diagonal is going to be different because you only have this transition from R to R minus one and from R to R. So there will be something tricky happening at the boundary. Then again, something slightly different that will happen if all the umbrellas are at her office. She wakes up, she has no umbrella. Then this means that no matter the weather in the morning, she cannot bring any umbrella at work, and then that's when she can get wet, okay, with probability P. So, morning, regardless of the weather, she cannot bring any umbrella at work. She's going to bring an umbrella back home, so we go from state 0 to state 1, with probability, the probability that it's going to rain in the evening, which is just probability P. So you see that all the transitions are of the form X, from X you go to X plus one or X minus one, as long as X plus one and X minus one are still in the state space, with probability PQ, with one exception, you go from state zero to state one with probability P, okay? So now I'm going to go to my whiteboard and write those equations, and we are going to do some math to see how to solve the problem. So now let's write some equations. So we said the goal is to study the Markov chain defined as Xn, so the process that keeps track of the number of umbrellas at home, in the morning of day N. Okay, so what we just saw with our empty cans is that, well, the state space is going to be anything between 0 and R. Okay, so we have state 0 here, 1 up to R. Okay, and we saw that from any state, you can go to the next one or the previous one with the same probability PQ. PQ. We saw also that from state R, we can jump to state R minus one. And this happens with probability, let me write the state below instead. This happens with probability PQ again, okay? And then at the opposite, from state zero, we are going to go to state one with probability P on. So there is something slightly different at the boundaries. And of course, what I didn't mention, but because we have a stochastic process, a Markov chain, what we want is the sum of the probabilities coming out of each state to be equal to one, which means that here you are going to have those extra arrows here, meaning that you can stay at the same state, and you have this everywhere. And so here the probability is going to be just 1 minus p. So if the system is in state zero, it stays in state zero with probability 1 minus p. Then here at the opposite, you have the sum of the probabilities like coming out here is 2pq, so here you need a 1 minus 2pq. So these are the expression of the transition probabilities. We can write that in a matrix, but before, I'm going to look a little bit at more qualitative behavior of the process. So the first thing you observe is that the state space is finite. Okay, you have r plus one states. Then it's also easy to see from the directed graph representation that the process is irreducible. So in fact, okay, we have arrows going both ways here. Okay, and so this means that from any state, you can go to any other state. And in terms of directed graph representation, that means that if we take any two vertices, we can indeed find a directed path going from one vertex to the other vertex. So that means that indeed the process is irreducible. Now you can also see that it's aperiodic, and the reason for that is because of all those arrows going back to the same state. Okay, so a process can be aperiodic even if pxx is equal to zero for all x, but in this case where we are in a nice case where pxx is strictly positive for all x, meaning that no matter where you are, the next day you can be in the same state. So in fact, we obtain that the process xn is finite, irreducible, and aperiodic. And we see this from the directed graph representation of the process. And from this, the theory of Markov chains tells you that not only the process xn, because it's finite and irreducible, the process xn is going to be positive recurrent, and consequence of positive recurrence is existence and also irreducibility, it's existence and uniqueness of a stationary distribution pi. Okay, so we know that there exists a unique stationary distribution pi, and even better than that, because also the process is aperiodic, we know that the limiting probabilities exist, which means that the limit when n goes to infinity of the probability that xn equals x is indeed going to be equal to pi x for all x in the state space. Okay, so we are in this, we have the three main ingredients: finiteness, irreducibility, aperiodicity, so that the Markov chain behaves very well. And so so now next step is to compute pi. So to compute pi, we need so this directed graph representation is not really going to help. What we need instead is to write explicitly the transition matrix. So I'm going to erase this part, and let's see the expression of the transition matrix. We already have parts of the coefficients here. So the transition matrix P is going to be equal to, so here you have state zero, the probability of staying in state zero is 1 minus p. So that's your coefficient here, 1 minus p. Then you go from 0 to 1 with probability p. So you have a p here. And I'm going to assume only 4 states, meaning 3 umbrellas, just to write the matrix. But this can be extended to any values of r. So after from 0, you cannot go to state 2 or 3. So you have zeros here. And then after, from any state, you go to the previous one, the next one with probability pq. So you have pq here again, and 0, and then 1 minus 2pq. Same thing for the next row, pq, 1 minus 2pq, and pq. And again, over exception for the last row, we again have probability of going to a neighbor that has probability PQ. So you have a PQ here. No, it's the PQ is there instead, sorry. It's the probability of going from R to R minus 1. So row R column R minus 1. But all those are zeros. So here, instead of a 1 minus 2 PQ, we are going to have just 1 minus PQ. And this is our transition matrix. So now to find the stationary distribution, so maybe we don't need this anymore. To find the stationary distribution, the next step is to solve pi p equals pi. So by existence and uniqueness of the stationary distribution, we know that there is a solution to this system. Zero is always a solution, but this one is not the one we are looking for. We want basically to obtain a one-dimensional vector space. So uniqueness of the stationary distribution means that the set of solutions of this system is a one-dimensional vector space. The solutions correspond to what we call stationary measures, but because we are doing probability theory, the only measure that matters for us is the one such that the sum of the coordinates is equal to one, called the distribution, the stationary distribution. So the theory tells us that there is a unique solution, not a unique solution, there are infinitely many solutions to this system, but a unique solution with sum of the coordinates equal to one, meaning that the set of solutions should be a one-dimensional vector space. So now the next thing we need to do is just to find a particular solution, and from this particular solution, we can deduce the expression of pi. So it might be a little bit tricky to find a particular solution, so I'm going to just skip the algebra and give you the answer. It turns out that if you try the vector q 1 1 1, that's going to work. Okay, or in general, the first coordinate is equal to q and the last r coordinates are equal to 1. So finding this solution by solving the system might be tricky. Now if we have a hint on what the solution can be, it's pretty easy to check that indeed this would work. And so you just observe that q111 times p is equal to, you just do the product. So the first coordinate here is going to be q times 1 minus p plus 1 times pq. So q1 minus p plus pq, 1 times pq. The second coordinate is going to be p times the q here plus 1 minus 2pq times 1 plus pq times 1. Eventually you end up with pq plus 1 minus 2pq plus pq. That's exactly equal to 1. So the next coordinate is 1. And then after you only have to multiply those coordinates by 1. And you see that again, this plus that is 1, this plus this is 1. So even if r is larger than just 3, eventually you obtain that the last coordinates are equal to 1. So now next step is just to observe that the q times p here minus q times p disappears with this 1. And so you are indeed left with q here. So eventually you get q 1, 1, 1. So indeed, we were able to prove that this vector q with only one factor is indeed a solution to this system. So the fact that it's a solution to this system means that the measure, not probability measure, but the measure that puts mass equal to q to state 0 and mass 1 to the other state, is indeed stationary, a stationary measure. Now, to get your stationary distribution, you need to make sure that the sum of the coordinates is equal to 1. but you know that all the solution to this system should be proportional to this vector. So the only solution you get, the unique solution you obtain, is pi equals q divided by the sum of the coordinates. In this case, it's going to be q plus 3. More generally, it's going to be q plus r. So you have a q plus r here. Then the second coordinate is 1 divided by q plus r, and so on. So this is our stationary distribution. So now we are done with the analysis of the Markov chain. We know that in the long run, the probability that xn equals 0 is going to be equal to q divided by q plus r, regardless of the initial state. And the probability that xn equals x is going to be equal to 1 divided by q plus r, again when n goes to infinity, for all x strictly larger than 1. So now the next step is to relate this event that Alice gets wet in the n with this stationary distribution pi. And for that, we are going to go back to our empty cans to see how those two things relate. But clearly, from what we saw before, it seems that the probability of an event that I'm going to call Wn for the event that Alice gets wet in the n is going to be related to pi 0 and pi r, okay? Because that's when she has no umbrella at home and no umbrella at her office in those two states, that there is a risk that she gets wet. So now that we are done studying our Markov chain, the last step is to relate the stationary distribution, the expression of the stationary distribution, with the probability that she indeed gets wet in the long run. So let's say in the n for n very large. So of course it's related to the fraction of time there is no umbrella at home or no umbrella at her office. And so it seems that the probability that she gets wet in the n is related to pi 0 and pi r. Okay, so let's assume first that we are in the configuration in state R, meaning all the umbrellas are at home. So in this case, how can she get wet that day? Well, she's going to get wet this day if it does not rain in the morning, probably Q, in which case she's not going to bring any umbrella at work, and she's going to be left with no umbrella in the evening, in which case she's going to be wet if it rains in the evening. So each time the system is in this configuration, so state R, she's going to get wet with probability P times Q, okay? Q, the probability that there is no rain in the morning, times P, the probability that it rains in the evening. Now, things are slightly different if all the umbrellas are at work. If she has all her umbrellas at work, then she wakes up in the morning, she has no umbrellas, and she's going to get wet. She cannot get wet in the evening because all her umbrellas are at her office, but she can get wet in the morning, and this happens with probability P. So, in short, each time you are in state 0, each time the system, the Markov chain is in state 0, Alice gets wet in the morning, so that day with probability P, and she gets wet in the evening if you are in state R with probability P times Q. So now we can combine this observation with the expression of the stationary distribution we found to compute finally the probability that she gets wet in the n when n goes to infinity. So we found that the stationary distribution of this process is given by this. Now, to deduce the probability that Alice gets wet based on the relationship between pi and the probability that Alice gets wet we just found, we are going to just call Wn, the event that Alice gets wet in the end. Okay, then we know that the probability, so the goal is to compute the limit when n goes to infinity of the probability of Wn. So if you condition, so clearly Wn is going to strongly depends on the state of Xn, okay, the value of Xn. So we are going to condition on Xn, but like we just saw, Wn cannot occur, the probability that the probability of Wn is zero given that Xn is different from zero and different from R. So we only need to condition on the two events, Xn equals zero and Xn equals R, and this gives us so limit when n goes to infinity of the probability of Wn given that Xn equals zero times the probability that Xn equals zero plus the probability of Wn Wn given Xn equals R times the probability that Xn equals R. So what we just saw is that each time there is no umbrella at home, okay, she's going to get wet with probability, well, the probability that it rains in the morning, which is just P. So eventually we get limit when n goes to infinity of P times the probability that Xn equals zero plus, and we also saw that when all the umbrellas are at home, she's going to get wet if it doesn't rain in the morning but it rains in the evening, which is an event with probability PQ. So PQ times the probability that Xn equals R. Okay, then last step is to observe that because we already proved that not only there is a unique stationary distribution given by pi here, but also the limiting probabilities, probability that Xn equals zero or X in general, indeed converge to the stationary distribution because the process is not only positive recurrent but also aperiodic. Taking the limit here, we simply get P times pi zero plus PQ times pi R. Now, if you replace by the expression we found, you get exactly PQ divided by Q plus R for this part, and then plus again PQ divided by Q plus R. So eventually you obtain 2PQ divided by Q plus R. So now what's interesting in this expression is to see that always that's something interesting to do in probability theory. Once you get your result, just check that it's indeed consistent with your intuition. And here, you see that clearly this quantity is decreasing with R, which makes sense. The more umbrellas you have, the less likely you are going to get wet. Now, what's interesting also is to see the numerator here. It's like 2PQ. And you see that if P is equal to zero, meaning that it never rains, then it makes sense that you don't get wet never. But also, if P is equal to one, meaning that it rains all the time, then Q is zero. Okay, Q is one minus P. So eventually this expression is again zero. So that tells you that when it rains every day, then you never get wet. Why is that? Well, it's because if it rains every day, you always carry with you an umbrella, okay? And so it kind of makes sense. This expression is not proportional to 2PQ because you have the Q here, but still you see that it's very small when it rains almost all the time, or it's very small also when it rains almost never. So, which means you don't get wet when the weather is very predictable, but then when P and Q are close to each other and approach one half, then that's the maximum for this term, that's equal to 1. And so that's basically when you are the most likely to get wet, excluding this Q here, but you understand the spirit. And so that concludes this example. So again, I just recap quickly. Here what we did is to be able to compute a limiting probability. So we introduced a Markov chain. So in this case, something that keeps track of number of umbrellas. We need to use the fact that the process is finite, irreducible, apiorally to prove existence, uniqueness of the stationary distribution, and also prove that indeed those probabilities converge to the corresponding terms of the stationary distribution. And last step in the problem was to use a little bit of conditional probability to relate the events we are looking at with the Markov chain itself. And that's it for this example.